name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. So we are, on account of his mercy for us in Jesus Christ, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God who not only created the world, but has acted graciously in history to restore it after its fall, has acted decisively, once and for all, in the sending of Jesus Christ, his Son, so that to all who receive him, who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children of God, born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Jesus, the incarnate, eternal Son of God, came into a world. Resurrection, which is yours by baptism and faith in his body and his blood, his resurrection and new life might be yours. And so it is, as the disciples on the road to Emmaus returned from their journey, having walked and talked with Jesus, not knowing who he was, until he revealed himself in the breaking of the bread that Easter night, that the disciples, now gathered together in the upper room, discussed these things. They discussed the testimony of the women who had seen the empty tomb, the testimony which had been verified by Peter and John themselves, who had gone into the empty tomb, the testimony of Mary Magdalene, who says that she had seen the risen Lord, and now the testimony of the Emmaus too. They discussed all these things behind closed doors for fear of the Jews, full of doubt. And there, in their midst, all of a sudden, stood Jesus, the only Son of God himself, with the proclamation, "Peace to you." Not a simple greeting, but a proclamation of peace. Peace be to you, peace with God. It is the proclamation of that very peace which his death had bought, and to which his resurrection testifies. The power of sin is death, and because Christ has conquered sin by his death, it could not hold him. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Risen is the final proof of God's forgiveness of sins. Reconciliation and peace brought and bought by his flesh and his blood on the cross. This is why during the communion liturgy we hold aloft the body and blood of Christ and proclaim, "The peace of the Lord be with you always." For it is that flesh and blood which brings peace. No longer are we rebels under God's judgment, but children of the Heavenly Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. Indeed, the Son of God became the Son of Man so that we might become sons of God. Now the disciples were frightened and startled, to say the least, and thought perhaps they had seen a spirit. Was this what Mary saw? Was this what the Emmaus disciples saw? The ghost of Jesus? His restless spirit come back to haunt them for their betrayal? A grim specter come to announce their demise? No, of course not. It is an absurd thing to think, for sure, and not one consistent with a scriptural worldview at all. A bit of superstition which found its way into their hearts by their doubt. For the sinner, that which is supernatural and false is often easier to believe than God's own truth. But he was not a spirit, but risen, and so Jesus asks them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? You foolish disciples! All has happened according to the Father's eternal plan, as the prophets and even me myself have told you. I was delivered up to be crucified by the priests and the scribes. I have borne your iniquities. I have been pierced for your transgressions. Upon me was the chastisement that brings you peace. I am not dead, but risen. See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Even now I bear the marks of your redemption. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" "Have you anything here to eat?" Jesus asks. "Is he hungry? Has his sleep in the tomb left him famished? Did his descent into hell and his ascension back to the life, the land of the living, bursting the gates of hell, left him starving?" No. In his resurrected and now glorified body, Jesus needs no food to eat. For a time, in the state of humiliation, he had set aside the full use of his divine powers so that he could hunger and thirst and suffer and die for our sake. But now he is risen and vindicated. He needs no sustenance for his body. His divinity communicates the infinity of his divine life to his humanity. His humanity is sustained by the very life of God. No, he is not hungry. No, he does not need to eat. But he can, because he is still a flesh and blood man. Because he is risen. "Have you anything to eat? Give me something to eat to further prove to you that I am risen," Jesus says. "Give me something to eat, and it will not be like that scene in Casper the Friendly Ghost where the ghostly uncles stuff their faces full of food and it just drops out through them." They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate before them to prove his bodily presence. And in this, too, we see the importance of table fellowship with Jesus. It was in the breaking of the bread that the Emmaus disciples recognized him. It is by sitting at table with the 10 that Jesus proves his resurrection. And it is in the Holy Supper, in which we commune with Jesus, that the risen and victorious Lord comes to us in his body and his blood so that we may believe. Again, Jesus testifies to them and reminds them of all that the prophets and he himself had taught them. "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem." "My dear disciples," Jesus says, "see what love the Father has for you, that you are called children on account of my death and resurrection. I am the gift given to you. It was God's gracious plan from the beginning, as announced beforehand in all the scriptures. In my name there is repentance and the forgiveness of sins. And where there is the forgiveness of sins, there's also life and salvation. This gift is not only for you, but to be proclaimed, beginning in Jerusalem, for I am from the Jews and came for the Jews, but extending to all nations, for my kingdom will have no bounds. All peoples are mine. The world did not know me, but rejected me, and it will reject you. It will persecute you, and you will participate in my suffering, but you will make me known. You are witnesses of these things. I give you my spirit now for the holy ministry, that you will pronounce forgiveness in my name. Whatever sins you forgive on earth will be forgiven in heaven. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father, the Holy Spirit, upon you in another way soon. On Pentecost, you will be clothed with power from on high to proclaim the gospel of my death and resurrection to the nations. Dearly beloved of God, it is this apostolic proclamation that comes to you. Jesus Christ died for your trespasses. You are forgiven, and his resurrection bodily from the dead, nail and spear marks and all, with a stomach to eat, is God's proclamation of peace to you. A picture also of what you will be in your resurrection. Indeed, by his great love, we are the children of the Father, sons of God through the only begotten Son of God. In the name of Jesus, amen. May rise for the offertory.